right. Much of the country is suffering from extreme cold weather, with 58 million people in below zero temperatures right now. As usual, when there's a significant cold, there are calls that cast doubt on climate change. Just this past Monday, President Trump tweeted this. In the beautiful Midwest, wind chill temperatures are reading minus 60 degrees, the coldest ever recorded. In coming days, expected to get even colder. People can't last outside even for minutes. What the hell is going on with global warming? Please come back fast. We need you. Let's assume for a moment the president really is confused about the difference between weather and climate. This is for you, Mr. President. Weather is a temporary condition. Today it's going to be 28 degrees, the low of 5. On Thursday in New York, it's going to be 15 degrees with a low of 11. Friday, high of 23, low of 70. God, that's crazy, right? How can you imagine that this is global warming, a steady increase in temperatures? Weather is a temporary condition. It's what's happening outside your window. It tells you what you're supposed to wear when you go to work today. Weather can vary from the typical climate of an area, like when there's an unseasonable or extreme warm or cold front. Climate, on the other hand, is a long-term trend over an area of the planet. It's measured over hundreds, thousands, millions of years. The climate is a way to predict what future conditions will be like. Like, weather tells you whether you should take an umbrella or not. I never do anyway. As evidence of climate change has accumulated, there's another point people, like the president, have latched onto, dismissing human efforts to curb rising temperatures. Listen.
I think something's happening, something's changing, and it'll change back again. I don't think it's a hoax. I think there's probably a difference, but I don't know that it's man-made.
All right, let me help you out with that, Mr. President. Take a look at this chart. CO2, carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, has fluctuated for hundreds of years. Fluctuated. Oh, look at this. There's a hundreds of thousands of years, by the way. This is 400,000 years. Look at this. Look what happens in 1950. The industrial age. Once humans got involved and started burning fossil fuels at increasing rates, this is what happened to CO2 output. And if that's not enough, there's this. Global temperature since 1984. Things are pretty steady through the end of the 1884, things have been pretty steady through the end of the 19th century, but as human industry builds up and the cumulative damage accrues, temperatures start rising in the 50s and the 60s. And by the 1980s, you can see how alarming the trend is becoming. But why do we actually care about this? Well, let's say you live or are someone who owns property in Florida or along the Gulf and Atlantic coasts. As the ice sheets melt, because the Earth is warming, the sea level rises incrementally. And if the Greenland ice sheets melt completely, sea levels along this area are going to rise by nearly 20 feet, swallowing Miami, New Orleans, and any other area that's shaded in red. You see how this increases. Let's continue to shade this. See this? All of this stuff shaded in red floods. Joining me now is NBC News technology correspondent Jacob Ward. Jacob, first of all, we hear so much from politicians, from people who doubt climate change. Well, it's cold where I am, or even claiming right, that we've got the coldest years on record globally, which actually isn't true. But of the 10 hottest on record, only two of them fall outside of the last 10 years. So tell me why these opposite ideas, these anti-science ideas, persist.
Well, I think it's exactly what you were pointing out about President Trump. You know, it's basically that our human sensor array is built mostly to just relate to other people in small groups sitting around a campfire. You know, we are not built as humans to grok huge abstract systemic changes. We're good at snakes and fire and the things that are right in front of us. And so we just don't have the apparatus to imagine the kind of scale of change. You see this in technology, you see this now in climate change. We just don't believe it unless it's happening in front of our eyes. And it turns out our eyes cannot help us with this problem.
Which is why some people relate to weather more than they relate to climate, right? Because weather That's is right. something I have to react to. I have to put on the right coat, and if I don't, I'll find out.
That's right. I'm experiencing this right now. How could it possibly be that the planet is getting warmer? And that's because, you know, the kinds of changes we're talking about happen over multiple lifetimes and can sweep all of us up in some huge systemic change that your eyes wouldn't necessarily show to you on a moment-by-moment basis. So, yeah, it's just one of these great challenges of human perception that even though the globe is warming over the course of hundreds of years, we, on a moment-by-moment basis, get tricked by our human senses into believing that the only thing we should believe is the thing that's right in front of us.
So help me out. Jake, you study this all the time. You know about this.
Right.
Maybe people are just intimidated to come up to you and say things like, you know, I don't think climate change is human-driven or that humans contribute to
right.
it. What is a guy like me who's not a scientist, what's the best answer to give people who continue to doubt whether climate change is actually a thing?
You know, I would say two things. You know, first, if you're the kind of person who wants to go head on at the argument, then go head on at the argument. I mean, you know, I wish that we could sort of, you know, hand out little placards or maybe get tattooed on our arms that 1950 line that you had there
right.
in that graphic, right? That when the Industrial Revolution hit, the trend started upward and then it just became a hockey stick and now it's a runaway thing. But if you don't feel like fighting, why don't you go the other way and just say, what is wrong with creating a more efficient, more environmentally sensitive world? We are only going to get better and better at making things if we learn how to make them in an ecologically and environmentally responsible way. It used to be that was the sort of, you know, window dressing you would put on at the end of a design project. But these days, any good architect, any good product designer is trying to make something that's environmentally sensitive. And so in my mind, I just think to myself, don't worry about it. If you just don't believe it existentially, fine. You know, I won't fight with you. But let's just get better at making these things in an environmentally mm-hmm. sensitive way, because it means that we're getting better at what we do.
Right. And by the way, folks who, when I showed that chart of water levels rising, the military,
right.
the Coast Guard, the Navy, they all actually understand this. They are trying to build and mitigate those things. So to the
yes.
degree that people around the world who have to do things about this are doing things, and in the United States, government agencies are dealing with it, state governments are dealing with it, municipalities
right.
are dealing with it. Does it matter, or let me ask you this, how much does it matter that the United States pulls out of the Paris Climate Accord?
Oh, it's huge, right? I mean, it's huge. We are one of the great emitters of carbon in the world. We and China are the two. And you could argue that we are, in fact, bound up with China's emissions because so much of our manufacturing takes place in China. So that's kind of our emissions, too. I mean, the United States, what you know, as we go, so goes the planet in many ways. So we really have to go with it. And for me, I just think that, you know, even though you hear at the top of the administration this sort of, you know, weird kind of, you know, vague dismissals of climate change, in the center of the government, places like, you know, the rescue teams that are right now trying to plan for the Northern Crossing, which they're planning to open up, right, where suddenly all the countries, Sweden, Norway, Russia, the United States, Canada, that are going to share that northern border, they're going to start sending ships across the northern portion of the globe because it'll be the fastest way to ship things.
Right.
And they're already starting to figure out, okay, can our helicopters rescue people in the middle of that? I mean, these are really practical people. And when you begin to hear military and rescue planners
yep.
planning for this kind of change, you know it's real. Those are not people who take a flyer on theoretical things.
Hey, MSNBC fans, thanks for checking out our YouTube channel. Subscribe by clicking on that button down there and click on any of the videos here to watch the latest interviews and highlights. You can get more MSNBC for free every day with our newsletters. Just visit msnbc.com/newsletters to sign up now.